Welcome, people of God. Today our worship is focused on the story of a family who was a really big mess. So if you are feeling like a bit of a mess this morning, you are in good company. You join a long story of people and families who were messy that God calls and recalls to join God's mission in the world. And you, with all of your complexity and holy mess, are welcome here. Whether you are physically in this sanctuary or joining us from elsewhere, consider this your invitation to bring your whole self to this time and this place for worship today. Join me in the call to worship. As when God called Abram and Sarai, God calls us today. As when Rebekah and Jacob wrestled with the blessing, God holds our wrestling today. As when Israel's family reconciled, God calls us to reconciliation today. As when Shifra and Pua stood for justice, God gives us courage today. As when the people cried for deliverance, God hears our cries today. Throughout history and today, God calls, reconciles, hears, and sticks with the people. And so we gather today, joining the story of the past to the story of the future. Becoming a people of God. Join now in singing Voices Together 32, God Welcomes All, and stand in body or spirit.
Please remain standing and let's turn to number 180. This is God's wondrous world.
Thank you.
Before we pray, I would just like to let you know that our community has experienced death this week. Melvin Lowen died on Friday after a steady decline following COVID last April. His funeral will be in Manitoba, and his family wants to thank this congregation for the care that was extended to Mel and Elfrida after they moved here to be closer to children and grandchildren. So remember this family in prayer. Join me in prayer. Here we are, God, your beautiful and richly varied and messy created people. Here we are with all of our deep joy and pain. You knitted us together before our existence was known. You stick with us when we attempt to flee from your presence. And you will be there when we cross over from life into death into eternal life. Receive our petitions and our longings and our gratitude. We give thanks for the changing of seasons, for the rhythm of your earth and the rhythm of life that calls us to. Open us up to the release of this fall season. And God, we know that you are with us in death. We thank you today for the lives of Eli Stoltzfus and Melvin Lowen. And we pray for Mario and his family and friends as he prepares to cross that threshold. Welcome these loved ones into your embrace and comfort all who mourn them. We long for health, health of body and mind and spirit, health of relationships. Today, for physical healing, we lift to you Trish, Santiago, Weldon, Wanda, Jose, Dwight, Luetta, Lucy, Adriana, and Brenda. For all of these dear ones named, and for those dear to us and for ourselves that are unnamed, we pray for your healing presence. God, you hear the groaning of the earth, and you grieve with us at the injustice that is both near and far from home. Give us ears to hear you and courage to join your healing and hope in the world. Receive the concerns and the joys of our hearts, those spoken and unspoken. Lord, hear these prayers. Amen. I invite families to come forward now for children's time with Pamela, and all of us can sing Voices Together 512. Let the children come to me.
Morning. It's good to see each of you today. Why are you laughing, Zeph? Why are you smiling? Or I saw you laughing, Michelle. Is there something wrong? with me? Do you see something strange about me? Ryan? Oh, I do, don't I? Oh, okay, well, I can still tell the story with different shoes on, right? Is there anything else? Ryan, why are you noticing? Oh, I did notice that I couldn't see this very well. That helps. Okay. All right, we're ready to go now, right? All right. Zeph, did you? What? Oh, can someone come help me fix this? Because I don't have a mirror, and I might have a brush over at my seat. Anything else? I guess I didn't come quite ready today. Ryan, why are you picking all these things out? Ryan, that's... Oh, am I supposed to do it myself? Well, okay. Is that good? Can you help me, Jasmine? Okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Oh my goodness. And you know what? I like things to match, and this doesn't even match. Okay. I am just a big hot mess today, aren't I? Well, thank you. Thank you for fixing me. I appreciate that. I guess it's a little risky to ask if there's something wrong, right? You might not like what you get for the answer. Well, how many of you have heard that phrase before? Big hot mess. Yeah. How many of you out here? Big hot mess, right? Well, that's what I came here today like. And I think you probably know that I knew that I was a mess, right? But I did that because I wanted to remind you of a couple stories. The first one happened just last week, and I was driving home to get some lunch, and I stopped at a stoplight, and I looked down, and I realized my shirt was on inside out. And I had been here at work for a few hours already, and I was like, huh. Okay, but fortunately, I had just been in my office mostly, and it was a shirt that people couldn't really tell too much that it was inside out, so no one here noticed. At least they said they didn't notice. Okay, so, and then it reminds me of another story that Pastor Talasha told me that one time, you know that she is the director of the theater program at Bethany, right? One time she went to one of her shows, and she introduces a show, and she looked, and she had two different shoes on. She had a blue one on and a black one on. And, okay, I may have heard a story like that about Pastor Madeline as well, but you can ask her about that. Now, that has nothing to do with us being women. It's just happened to be the people that I talked to about my shirt being inside out the other day, and I was laughing at myself. Well, the story today this week and next week is about a family in the Bible that kind of is a big hot mess. Have you ever been like me? On, let's say, Sunday morning or getting ready for school, you all just go out like with your hair all done and you're buttoned up just right, got your shoes and socks on, the right feet and everything. Everything's great on Sunday mornings, right? And when you're getting ready for school, you've never put your shirt on inside out? Zeph has? Anybody out here? It's okay to admit it, right? Sometimes we just are a little bit of a mess because we're in a hurry or we're distracted or we're hungry or we're tired, right? And that's okay. Well, the stories that we're going to learn about today and next week and that you're hearing about in worship and in Sunday school is the story, the big family of Abraham and Sarah, or Abram and Sarai. And then as they're called, their names are changed to Abraham and Sarah. Well, they were a bit of a big hot mess. And I'm just going to go through a few things pretty quickly about how they were a bit of a mess. Abraham had a habit of lying when he was nervous and telling people that his wife was his sister. Sarah, his wife, really his wife, had a habit of laughing at times that it was not appropriate to really be laughing, and she also would get jealous. And she was especially jealous of her slave girl, Hagar, who gave birth to Abraham's first son, Ishmael, and she was pretty mean to Hagar. Eventually, Abraham and Sarah had a son, Isaac, who married Rebecca, and they had two sons. Anyone know their names? Seth? Jacob and Esau. And these boys would fight. They even fought when they were in their mother's womb. Can you imagine that? Little babies fighting in their mother's womb. And in the Bible, it tells us that even when Esau was being born, Jacob was holding on to his heel, like kind of trying to keep a hold of him as he was being born. Well, it probably didn't help either with these two guys fighting. And you never fight with your brothers and sisters, right? Never all get along right. That their parents, Isaac and Rebekah, played favorites. So Isaac's favorite was Esau, and Rebekah's favorite was Jacob. That probably didn't help them get along and stop fighting, did it? So Esau kind of lost his marbles when he got really hungry, and he lost his sense, and he got easily tricked because his hunger was just like taking over his brain. And Jacob was a little bit tricky, and he started taking what really wasn't his. And eventually it got even worse, and Jacob had to run away because he thought Esau was going to kill him. And it just goes on and on and on. Does it sound kind of messy? They were a big hot mess, right? Well, let's just say that they were a mess. And they were a mess of lying and jealousy and tricking and laughing and fighting and running away. But they were still God's children. And God loved them. And he still saw parts of this family that he could find good in and many gifts to bless people. Abraham, Sarah, Hagar, Ishmael, Isaac, Rebecca, Esau, Jacob, and their children's children, they were a big hot mess, but a big hot mess that God used to bless many upon this earth. So, as you listen today to the sermon and next Sunday, and as you learn in Sunday school, and as you read your Bibles, and as you think about this, I want you to think about looking and hearing about all the mess in these stories. And I also want you to think about how God was at work in all that mess and still was calling these people. And that even in the mess of our lives, God still calls us, you know, even if we show up to church or our theater program with the wrong colored shoes, we can still do what we're called to do. And we can share God's love and goodness in the world. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you are a loving God, that even when we are a big hot mess and we make mistakes, we lose our way, that you help us, that you love us. We are still your children. You still call us. And I pray that as each of us go about our lives, that you would remind us that even when times are messy and complicated, that you are at work in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can go back to your seats. And I think I see my right shoe over there, so I'm going to fix that.
The Lord your God is with you. Number 173.
Our preacher this morning is our pastoral team leader, Phil Waite. Join me in a prayer of blessing. God, we thank you for gathering us here this morning. And we thank you for gathering us in all throughout the week, when we are together and when we are apart. You are always at work, inspiring and leading. We thank you for the work that you have been doing in Phil, as he prepares for this sermon. We pray that you will bless him and all of us in these words this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
For some reason, I'm feeling a little more self-conscious about my appearance. Not sure why that is. The peace of Christ be with you all. Let us greet each other with the peace of Christ. Our scripture this morning is found in the book of Genesis, chapter 27, beginning with verse 30. As soon as Isaac had finished blessing Jacob, when Jacob had scarcely gone out from the presence of his father Isaac, his brother Esau came in from his hunting. He also prepared savory food and brought it to his father, and he said to his father, "Let my father sit up and eat of his son's game so that you may bless me." His father Isaac said to him, "Who are you?" He answered, "I am your firstborn son, Esau." Then Isaac trembled violently and said, "Who was it then that hunted game and brought it to me, and I ate it all before you came, and I have blessed him? Yes, and blessed he shall be." When Esau heard his father's words, he cried out with an exceedingly great and bitter cry and said to his father, "Bless me also, father." But he said, "Your brother came deceitfully, and he has taken away your blessing." The word of the Lord. Eugene Peterson, an author, pastor, was here in Elkhart many years ago, Elkhart County, and he was at the Mennonite Seminary in Elkhart for meetings. And he wanted to connect with his Mennonite audience, so he told this story one of his early encounters as a young person with Mennonites. And he was at a wedding, and there was a Mennonite pastor at this wedding. And somebody had spiked the punch at this wedding, and the Mennonite pastor kept going back for more and more and more, having no idea what was happening. Like just completely, like, this is great punch. And Peterson's comment on this pastor was he was not very discerning. And that was his conclusion about this pastor, and trying not to generalize, of course, to all Mennonites from that one experience. When I read about this story about Isaac, I think, this is not a very discerning person, to say the least. I read kind of the end of this bit of story, right, where Jacob goes and he's got these furs on his arms, and he's trying to sound like Esau, and Isaac is just deceived by the whole thing. You know, we say Jacob deceived his father, but, well, his father was deceived, right? I mean, this seems like a pretty simple ruse. And the text plays it up for comedy. Like, this is kind of pokes fun at Isaac. Isaac was the child of promise. We have these themes for each Sunday that come from the Shine curriculum, and it says, the child of promise, Isaac, the child of promise. And if you look at the book of Genesis, starting with chapter 12, we've got chapter after chapter after chapter that builds up this child of promise who's going to come. And through this child of promise, the whole world's going to be blessed. Chapter 12, chapter 13, chapter 14. On it goes with God coming to Abraham and saying, "Yes, you're old, but I'm going to bless you. You're going to be so blessed. You're going to be blessed with this child." And here comes Isaac. Am I wrong here? This is a disappointment. Here is a man who is not competent. He's not brave or heroic, possesses none of the classic virtues. What is it about Isaac that makes him special? The answer to that question is not one thing makes him special other than he was the promised child. I'm reminded of the words of the prophet Isaiah. There's nothing special about him, nothing about him that would make us think this is a great person. And as I reflected on this and on this family, which Pamela highlighted so nicely this morning, this mess of a family, I thought, well, you know what? This is kind of a strand through the whole of Scripture. The whole of Scripture sort of highlights a people, God's people, who really aren't very, very remarkable. There's nothing that stands out about them as particularly good or competent or heroic or virtuous. In fact, one might say that what makes them special is that they are really, they score really low on all of those measures. A favorite story of mine, we could tell many stories in this vein, right? A favorite story of mine is the story of Gideon. God comes to Gideon and says, "Gideon, you mighty warrior." There's sarcasm if I've ever heard it. And Gideon's response is, Gideon knows. Gideon knows what the deal is. I am the youngest person in the least important clan and the least important tribe. Why me? And so Gideon forms an army. And the army's too big. And God says, you got to whittle down this army. And you know what God does? Like one of my favorite little stories in all of Scripture is God says, all right, take all the soldiers down to water, and the ones that lap like dogs, that drink water like dogs, those are the ones you want in your army. That's their qualification. This is what God expects of the people. This is what it means to qualify to be worthy of God's blessing. And God says clearly to Gideon why. God says the reason why is that I want to make my power manifest. And I don't want you all to be confused and think that it's your goodness, your greatness, your heroism, your bravery, your virtues, your competence that have accomplished these things. And we see this, the strand keeps going, right? We see Nathan, the prophet Nathan, going to Jesse's house, looking to anoint the new king. God says, go to Jesse's house, and you will find there the new king that you are to anoint. Then he goes to the first one and says, oh my, this is quite the impressive person, tall and strong, clearly possesses a great deal of competence. Classic virtues, you can just see it. And God says, no, 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 no. You don't get it. I don't look at people the way that you look at people. I don't look on the outward appearance. I don't look at the things that you can see and perceive. I look on the heart. Very strange. I don't look to make sure that the shoes are matched or the socks are matched. Socks are matched. Any of those things. I don't look at those things. I look on the heart. And this continues on into the New Testament. Have you ever looked at the way that the disciples are portrayed in the Gospels? Have you ever thought about this? These people are clueless. They're incompetent. They're cowardly. They possess none of the classical virtues. They're not strong. They're not heroic. There's nothing about them that would say, oh, yes. They didn't win any contest to get to be Jesus' disciples and prove themselves these great people. Can you imagine a reality TV show getting to be one of Jesus' disciples? We're going to choose the best and the brightest. No. Jesus chooses the least likely to be disciples. There they are. He says, follow me. Very strange. Two of my favorite little passages to illustrate this are one where the follower of Jesus ends up running naked in the garden. They grab his linen cloak and off he goes because he's running away. That is kind of emblematic right there of the disciples of Jesus running off and having their cloak grabbed and off they go without their cloak. leaving the cloak behind. There it is. Or when Jesus gets exasperated and just finally says, in the incident with the bread, and they're expecting literal bread. Jesus is asking us to go buy food. And Jesus says, don't you get it? Don't you even understand the concept of metaphor, for starters? But don't you understand? What is wrong with you people? And I'm going to say, Jesus, you're the one that called them. You called them the way that they are. So this thread runs through all of Scripture in various ways, right? It says, if we are called to follow Jesus because we are woefully unqualified to be God's servants. Strange thing. Strange thing. There's also this piece, and we must acknowledge it. We must acknowledge that there's a tension here, and that is Jesus, that God with the people of Israel, and Jesus certainly in the Gospels places heavy, heavy demands on the people, right? It seems like heavy demands. A rigorous ethic. Turn the other cheek. Go the second mile. Love your neighbor as yourself. These are demanding ethic. This is a demanding ethic that Jesus places on the people. And so we have this tendency to look at that and say, okay, we've got to be perfect. We've got to be good. We've got to be like that because God demands it of us. And there's this rigorous ethic. Being a follower of Jesus means we've got to be up here. This is a high bar. We've got to get over that bar. And I think when we do that, we miss the point. There's this remarkable encounter. It's a bit, I don't know. It's a bit one of those things that maybe you don't want to teach in children's Sunday school because it's a little bit questionable. It's a little bit strange. But Jesus is invited to the house of Simon the Pharisee for dinner. And he goes to Simon's house. And a woman comes in and anoints him, just pours oil onto Jesus as an act of love. And Simon and the guests are going, do you know who she is? What's going on here? I mean, it's an uncomfortable scene, to say the least. And Jesus, of course, can discern. Jesus, unlike that Mennonite pastor in Kalispell, Montana, Jesus is very discerning and can see what's going on. And Jesus says, let me tell you a story, Simon. Suppose there are two people who are in debt. One has a debt of 500 denarii and the other has a debt of 50 denarii. And the holder of those debts forgives them both. Which one do you think will love their creditor more? Which one do you think will? Well, the answer is the one with the bigger debt. And Jesus says, that's right. This woman who has come here has many sins, and her sins are forgiven. How much more will she love? And in that story, I think, lies the entire point of this tension within Scripture, and maybe the entire point of the Gospels. This story, from Genesis on through, is a story about God's love, God's gift being made known. This is not a story of human competence. This is not a story of human wisdom and discernment and heroism and virtue and bravery. This is a story of the power of God being made known. This is a story of love and a story of forgiveness. We live, I think, in unforgiving times. We expect a lot of ourselves in these days. Maybe this is true of all times. And it seems like a lot is expected of us. Have you ever think about this? You look at our criminal justice system and the shape of our criminal justice system. It's a great example of the way that our society is structured and the way that we think. We use the language of debts, do we not? A debt to society. You have a debt to society, and the way that you pay your debt is by doing time in a facility, in an institution that's cruel. It's awful. And somehow we call this justice. It's unforgiving. And it's the kind of world that we live in. Let's talk about monetary debt. We live in a world where people are burdened with debt, financial debt, of all kinds. Whether that's school debt, or a mortgage that you can't pay, or credit card debt, or for some of us at College Mennonite Church, it's a debt to a drug cartel for helping to get to this country, to this place. Burdened with debt. And the debt must be paid, whether it's a drug cartel or whether it's the government or whether it's a lending agency of some kind or another. The debt must be paid. Debts must be paid. An unforgiving society. And we have cameras everywhere looking at our every move. We have computers, technology that's following our every step. Nothing about our lives is hidden. It's as if we have a world that's kind of looking, waiting for us to slip up in some way or another. We have to be vigilant because our world is unforgiving. Thanks be to God. God does not look at us in this way. God is forgiving, and God's forgiveness is a gift, not given to us because we have proven ourselves worthy, because we are competent and hardworking, because we are generous. It's just a gift. Psalm 103 says that God is merciful. That one of the core characteristics of who God is mercy. That God does not remember our sins, but forgives our iniquities and removes them from us as far as the east is from the west. But you know what God does remember? God remembers that we are dust. That we are frail. That we are human. I often think that we forget this about ourselves, or certainly that we forget this about each other. But God remembers this and has compassion for each one of us. The Apostle Paul says, we have this treasure in clay jars. This treasure, this gift of God's love, of God's forgiveness. Not in jars that are beautiful and finely decorated and made out of the most beautiful porcelain, but common, rough, maybe cracked clay jars. This gift, this treasure. For our world, for our unforgiving world, and for such a time as this. Amen.
Our hymn of response is number 191. Oh, come, O thou traveler unknown. This is the story of when Jacob, who was feeling lost from God, wrestled in the night, looking for that comfort and love that God still provides when we're lost.
The Mennonite Central Committee Relief Sale is here in our town in just 2 weeks, so we've really got to make our coins count this Sunday and next with My Coins Count. This money goes for water projects around the world. So if you have some coins on you, bring them on up during our offering time, or stockpile them for next week and bring them next week. Make a joyful noise in bringing all of our offerings forward as we sing together 757, 757, There's Enough for All.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you have blessed us. Not that we have earned your blessing, but you have blessed us just out of pure gift. As these coins are being dropped into this bucket, you have showered us with your gift. And so we worship you and we give you thanks and we return these gifts to you as a sign of our love for you. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to stand as we sing our sending hymn, number 830.
Before our benediction, I'd like to introduce someone to you. Joseph, can you wave? Joseph is here. He's our new director of technology. Joseph might look familiar to some of you because he was part of our worshiping community while he was at Goshen College as a student. And we are delighted to have him back among us in this new role. So welcome him as you see him around today and in the weeks and months to follow. I also want to invite everybody on behalf of CMC Student Aid to join in a Sunday school time in the Koinonia rooms. Rebecca Stoltzfus, president of Goshen College and a member of CMC, is going to be sharing during the Sunday school hour, and her presentation is called What Does Mennonite Higher Education Have to Offer the World? So all are warmly invited to join there. Hear these words of benediction. May God show up in the midst of mess. May God walk with you and wrestle with you and lead you. And may God give you peace. Amen. Go in peace.